There are handouts. If you didn't get one, they are on that chair there as you come in. So what I'd like to do is just a few minutes of something that I did in Weimar at the what was called the YHIP conference and Yiddish Historically Informed Practice Conference, which was last summer. And that was a brief presentation. This will be a much briefer presentation of a brief presentation. So this is what I'd like to do is just show some phenomena which I find interesting. A little couple of disclaimers. First one is that there is definitely dispute over whether what I'm about to show should be called modal, which is a good question, but I'm not going to get into that right now. But in that presentation, which was 20 minutes or something, I looked at two things which one could call mode in sort of this milieu of Eastern European Jewish musical practice, and looked at connections between chazanut or chazonis and klezmer instrumental music and Yiddish song. And so this may not be news at all to some of you, but I think it's interesting to a lot of people. Anyway, so the one half of this that I would like to do is looking at what is often called Lernensteiger or study mode, which is very, seems to be a very pervasive phenomena crossing all of those areas. So I want to play you a few things. But before I do, I just want to say, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the late Max Wohlberg's article on these connections. I read it years ago when I was first starting to get into learning more about Eastern European Jewish religious music, and it was very informative. Then I have to say now I've gone back after many years and looked at it, and after you know, all the study that I did at JTS, formal study of Nusa, and formal study of cantillation of tropes, so to speak. It's even more informative, and though I'm not sure I agree with everything, there's a ton there, so I would recommend that to anyone who's interested in this, and I have a copy of it here. Okay, so let me play you something. I'm going to play you a few things quickly. The first two are from, you can get them, they're on the Bernatsky Library CDs that were released. They're hard to get, but you can get them, and they are field recordings from the early part of the 20th century. They are of what scholars call the scratchy, hard to hear variety of recording. This is literally a recorded example of study, a common study. You raised your hand twice. Okay. I have. Oh, you weren't here, that's why.
I don't get to hear anything.
I couldn't hear it. Okay. I have some Bhakmanasraman that is from the same, you know, the same era, the same, I think it was collected by Engel. I'm not going to play that now in the interest of being under 10 minutes. Here is, you can look at your handout and you will see a text there for Kayla Devorim. And this is generally considered to be in study mode. This is a text that one reads every morning and traditionally. And this is a commercial recording. This is the great Cantor Hirschman. And you'll hear it's quite within an arrangement by Rappaport, and it's very, 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 very orchestrated. But you get the idea. I promise, I really did organize this. Follow along in the words in the translation. Is more questions than answers. This was a very shallow dive. In the original presentation, I also looked at the Ukrainian Dorian phenomenon, which is sort of sexier in a way, so to speak, but I think that this is more common. So that is something I want to continue to look at. And again, I'm going back through the Wolberg, which is great. Okay, questions may come up. When I first started getting into this years ago, we invited Cantor Sam Weiss to
Klez
Canada,
yeah,
and he talked about this.
Use the mic.
Oh.
We invited Cantor Sam Weiss
to Klez Canada, and we asked him, he said, well, so is this, you know, where does this all come from? And one theory he had, and I think others have, is that it's related possibly to Haftorah trope. Maybe. So that's one question. I'd like to look into that a little bit more. Question two, you know, I remember JTS studying with David Ruskies and others and Doug Fishman and talking about the different social milieu of men and women. And especially listening to Ethel, you know, what are the differences between a men's tradition and a woman's tradition? And I'm sure there's writing about that that I haven't got into yet. But, and finally, there isn't. Okay, so that's, I think that's a really interesting thing.
That's the problem.
And then there's one that's unrelated, and I'll end with this, but I just find it really interesting. At my current job, which is very Reform, and a lot of older traditional Reform Jews, they get really upset when I go, ay, ay, ay. Really upset when I go, ay, ay, ay. And I was told, don't do that. But I could sing the exact same things if I went la, 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 or li, li, li. So I have this theory, which is completely unsupported, that it has to do with a Zionist idea of, because if you look at the songs that I know from, you know, this sort of constructed Zionist folklore, they, you almost never see ay, ay, ay. You see la, 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 la. So I wonder if that attitude got into American Judaism. Anyway, we can talk about that more later. That's it. Thank you.